issues in regards to falling international reserves, weak public finances, and low-rate economic growth. So I think those three issues should be really important on the discussion on Facebook.
All right, thank you very much, Vincent. So you now know you've got many ways in which to participate in the show tonight. But first off, let me start by having a conversation with Andy. So first, Andy, it's 10 years since the 2008 financial crisis. And before we look forward, I'd like to look back a little bit and ask you, give sort of, what sense do you have of what has been happening so far that would give us some kind of confidence for the future?
Well, I think you have to recognize that the world is a much safer place than it used to be 10 years ago. There have been a large number of policy initiatives, and let me just spell out a few. Banks around the world are much better capitalized than they used to be. There's the organization in Basel, the Financial Stability Board, that has set standards for bank liquidity and bank capitalization around the world. There have been many other policy improvements. But primarily, I think the thing that we have to be confident about is that central banks have experienced this sort of thing recently. And first of all, that means that they know how to deal with them better, okay? So they know how to deal with crises. And there have been many policy innovations like quantitative easing in the United States, negative interest rates in Asia and also Europe, forward guidance. But above and beyond that, central banks have been through this. They realize how terrible these crises are. So does the public. There is very little appetite for another financial crisis. And so there's much more incentive for central banks to be super careful. And I think they have been very careful. And that's the reason why I think we haven't experienced another financial crisis since.
But some of the analysts suggest that we could have another crisis at some point. They say these things come in cycles. Do you have a sense of that?
There will be another crisis eventually. I don't think it's going to be in my lifetime, and I certainly don't think it's going to be nearly the severity of this one. The 2008-2009 crisis was the most severe financial and economic crisis that the world has experienced in three generations, and yet it didn't lead to a Great Depression as in the 1930s. There's been no Second World War as there was a 10 years after the first Great Depression. Really, the world's in much better shape than it was.
You're suggesting, I'm suggesting you're a brave man to make that forecast that there won't be another one in your lifetime.
That was a hope, but it's also a forecast. But I do think that if there is another financial crisis, it won't be nearly as serious. Policymakers all around the world realize that financial institutions that are too big, especially too big to fail, have to be much more seriously regulated. So there's all sorts of supervision that didn't exist before. And really, the banks themselves are much better off than they used to be.
You talk, though, about a situation that we need to face up to in relation to the whole matter of bank regulation. With the Trump ascendancy, they're moving to do away with a lot of those regulations that were imposed or put in place by President Obama. What happens there?
I think that that's a slight overstatement. So the Dodd-Frank bill that went through was a very important bill, but it was an enormously complex bill. Anytime the United States Congress or any other legislative body puts through such a complicated piece of legislation, there are always mistakes that are made, things that are realized after the fact. So far as I can see, what's happening in the Congress right now is there's relatively minor tweaking to the Dodd-Frank bill. Probably doesn't go in the right direction, but it's probably not a big deal. It really is just a definition of what's a very large bank, and I don't think that's a serious cause for concern, certainly not compared with other things that are happening because of the Trump administration.
Such as?
Well, there's a very long list there. This is the moment when I get to say I'm proudly Canadian, as well as American. I'm an economist. I worry about economic things, so I'm worried about an outbreak of protectionism. But so far as I can see, as a citizen of the world, I'd be much more worried about war breaking out, either with North Korea or conceivably in the Middle East because of Iran. But from a personal point of view, it's the undermining of American institutions and the rule of law and the international liberal democratic order that really concerns me most. You have the United States that tried to create a rules-based system to govern the world, so that the United States was bound by the same rules as everyone else. And we are the ones that are undermining it, and that is a fundamental cause for concern.
That is going to have an effect on, say, the operations of the World Trade Organization.
Sure, the World Trade Organization has been undermined. Now, I don't think the World Trade Organization is the most important issue. Most trade liberalization does not take place through the WTO these days. The Doha round failed, and so there's been no big multilateral trade liberalization. Most of the trade liberalizations these days are regional. And the WTO helps out with them, but they don't really lead on them. However, any disputes between countries on trade-related issues are supposed to be resolved by the WTO. And for instance, the China tariffs that Trump announced just less than a week ago, he didn't even bother to go through the WTO. And that undermines its legitimacy. And if the largest countries in the world can do it, small ones can do it too, and that's a serious fear.
I have to share with you the experience of a Caribbean state, Antigua Barbuda. Of course, their gambling sector, offshore gambling sector, was devastated by the United States action. They went to the WTO, and the WTO ruled against the US, and they've not responded in any way. Negotiations going on over and over again. So this is a big state versus a small state.
And fortunately, the United States often loses when it goes to the WTO and often ignores it. But before, we at least paid lip service to the idea that we would try to settle accounts and to try to settle our disputes through the WTO. And we encouraged others to do so now. Now, with the United States behaving in a unilateral fashion, it's a worry for anyone living in a small country, such as Canada or Barbados.
So hope for NAFTA?
There's always hope for NAFTA. Don't forget, large numbers of American businesses have their supply chains well bound up in NAFTA. If the United States were to pull out of NAFTA unilaterally, American business would be extremely upset. Large numbers of jobs would be lost. It would be very disruptive. That doesn't necessarily mean that Trump won't do it. He doesn't seem to care about consequences. This is a man who has the power to pull the United States out of NAFTA and doesn't seem to think strategically. He never thinks ahead, especially on trade-related issues.
You're worried?
Of course I'm worried, yes. I don't think any reasonable person in the world should not be worried. Even if you're a believer in Trump, and there are some around, no one believes he's stable. Everyone thinks he's volatile. And most of the time, his believers think he's volatile in a good way. But yes, I'm fundamentally worried. I think everyone should be fundamentally worried.
But don't we see two pictures here? The Trump picture, which you just described adequately, but the contrasting business activity, for instance, in the United States, it would seem to me that the business sector is just going ahead and saying, look, we're going to write and continue doing what we're doing.
I think that's right. The United States is doing quite well economically right now. It's not growing at 3%, but it's growing at 2% and more. Inflation is low, unemployment is low. Things are stable, perhaps surprisingly so, but in a good way. The same thing is true in Europe. Europe is also a very vulnerable economy right now, especially with Brexit going on and the recent Italian elections. Greece is always an issue, and yet the European economy seems quite stable and growth has returned. I don't really know what's driving this, but most of the time, growth is the normal thing, and we should just appreciate it, and let's hope it continues.
So Angela Merkel has sorted out her coalition government. You've got the Italians with a new administration. You talk about Greece remaining a problem, but in reality, it would seem to me that the EU grouping is on a rebound in real terms of the Eurozone.
I guess I don't agree with you. It strikes me that the Italian elections, which are less than a month old, were a complete disaster for the European Union. You had an extremely right-wing party, the League, which used to be known as the Northern League and just appealed to the north of Italy, and it still does. It's a virtually fascistic party, and they did very well politically. The other group that did even better politically was the Five Star Movement, which has no serious policies of its own except to oppose mainstream ones. And that's almost all from the south. So you have this north-south divide, a serious left-right divide. The only thing that combines these two political parties of the extreme left and right is their hatred of the European Union. And Italy is a very large part of the European Union. If there's a serious crisis in Italy, it's going to affect Europe and therefore the entire world.
But some are suggesting, though, that again, Merkel having sorted out a German situation, France teaming up with Germany, that might very well be the driving force to keep the union together.
Sure, they could. And don't forget, when Merkel was faced with faced off against Sarkozy in France, they did rescue Greece, they rescued Portugal, they rescued Ireland. But Italy is much bigger. Italy is one of the six founding members of the European Economic Community. And the crisis in Italy is a manifestation of the fact that there's enormous distance between the populace all over Europe and the European Union sitting in Brussels.
Let's turn our attention to China now specifically and go beyond the tariffs and so on. Great anxiety about where China is going. It has revised a lot of the growth targets. It used to have 12, you know, double-figure targets, et cetera, now somewhere in the region, 6.5 and so on. They have the long view. The West or the rest of the world doesn't have the long view. How do you see China shaping up as it attempts to become a superpower?
So before I start, I do want to disagree with you just a little bit.
You're allowed to.
That's good. China does have the long view. I agree with you on that. The West, for the most part, doesn't. But East Asian societies, all up and down Asia, seem to have the long view as well. It's not just China. It's also Korea, Japan, perhaps less so, but Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore is a country that always thinks 20 and 30 years ahead, as does China. Nevertheless, China is clearly a very important part of the world economy and the world politic. I guess I'm a little bit worried that Xi has built a personality cult. You have a dictatorship in China that is running very smoothly right now. So benevolent dictatorships, when they run well, everyone's happy with them. But the only thing you know about a dictatorship is that it's a dictatorship. You don't know that it's going to be benevolent forever. Right now, there's political repression, but economic growth. The economic growth has slowed. That was completely inevitable. You had hundreds of millions of underemployed peasants all over the Chinese landscape. They moved to the east. They acquired good jobs. Welfare improved dramatically. You had hundreds of millions of people moved out of poverty in China over the last 20 years. That's a great thing. Growth was inevitably going to slow, but it's still proceeding apace. So what would be considered to be a bad year for China right now, 6%, almost every other country in the world would just love to have that problem.
So they've taken the long view again in terms of the world's precious metals, for instance. They've gone very strongly into Africa, certainly into Central America, and they're very ever present across the Caribbean, making themselves available to fund the development of major projects, infrastructure projects, etc. Some people suggest, oh, we don't want the Chinese, but we need them.
Well, my view is the world should be an open place. If China is offering money, one should take it. China, however, usually doesn't offer money. Usually what they do is, instead of aid, they offer loans, and the loans have to be repaid. And they're usually very focused on Chinese interests. So they're not always a good deal for developing countries. It is true that they're raising their profile in the world. That's probably a good thing, because we want them to be a serious and responsible member of the international community. China is doing what's in its best interest, but they don't always make the right decision. So you're right that they're trying to corner some markets for certain metals, like cobalt is the most recent one. But when they tried to do the same thing for rare earths less than a decade ago, that worked out very badly for them. And they tried to corner a market, they couldn't corner a market, they ended up paying a fortune. China makes mistakes too. And all we hope is that they continue to be a reasonable and responsible international player. I'm somewhat optimistic on that, but not completely optimistic.
Talking of a responsible player, let's turn our attention to Russia now. And we see Mr. Putin having taken some property, which he considered his right as a grand old Russian state. Mm. That's one thing. He's now boasting, of course, of having superior arms, etc. His whole tone is such that many people in Eastern Europe are a little concerned. And then we look at the interference of his people, clearly identified now as having interfered with elections in several countries, United States and Europe, etc.
Mm-hmm.
Are we in for a real Cold War?
I think we are, and I just hope that the West can unite as it did when the original Cold War broke out. The scary thing right now is that the United States is not leading a coalition against Russian interference. They're being dragged along. The Republicans used to accuse Obama as leading from behind, but the United States is nowhere near the forefront of confronting Putin on very serious foreign incursions into all sorts of domestic events. I mean, the most recent murders in the UK were probably the most dramatic, but they've been continuing for a long time. But I don't see a coalition in the West to oppose him. Angela Merkel in Germany never leads. France is far too small. The United Kingdom is in complete disarray. And you have a president of the United States who seems to admire Putin and who forces Russian diplomats out as a last-ditch response to try and be part of a coalition. So I'm worried that the United States will not be part of, or certainly not a forceful part of, a coalition against Russia, and it has to be part for any coalition against Russia to succeed.
All right, you raised the United Kingdom and talking about their plight, et cetera, but let's go to the Brexit story. A lot depends, as the analysts say, that the United Kingdom succeeds in getting good trade arrangements with the European members that they were associated with or associated with right now.
Mm.
That really raises some questions for us, particularly in the Caribbean. If Britain succeeds in getting those negotiations, we're looking at what our relationship will be, not only with Britain, but certainly with the European Union.
I mean, there is no way that the UK is going to be able to organize its trade association, its trade deal, whatever it comes down to, with the European Union by the deadline that they've established. There's just no way.
2019 is too short.
2029 is probably too short. I mean, it took the skilled negotiators of the European Union and Canada a decade to figure out a deal just between Canada and the European Union. And neither side is so aggressive against each other. So I can't imagine that we'll see any serious negotiations concluded for Brexit over the foreseeable future. And that's just going to lead to tremendous uncertainty for anything that's related to British commerce. And certainly Barbados is very seriously affected because the UK sends lots of tourists down here, and they're involved in lots of other businesses directly. That's not going to be good news for the countries in the Caribbean that do lots of business with the UK.
What should our attitude be, though, in the circumstances? Do we wait and hope that these things develop that will benefit us, or we have to forge a whole new relationship with both the UK and with the European Union?
Well, in some sense, you want the Brexit negotiations to be tough because the Barbados and none of the Caribbean countries are at all directly affected, so you want the UK to turn more away from the European Union towards other countries with which it engages in commerce. But that said, anything that adversely affects the UK is going to be bad for anyone doing business with it. If I were in charge, and I have no desire to be in charge, I would say diversification away from the UK is a good idea, and Latin America seems to be the most obvious choice for the countries in the Caribbean.
Well, our tourist people won't be very happy to hear that, because we've invested a lot in marketing the UK and Europe. But, you know, there have been several attempts over the years to try and wake up the Latin American market. All right. Can we talk about oil now? We used to be at $100+ a barrel.
Mm-hmm.
We're down in the $50 range, and in fact, that is the number that many of the Caribbean governments are looking at in terms of setting up their budget exercises each year. Is there a prospect that oil will go further up?
There's always the prospect. I mean, things could go badly with Iran, and anything that cuts off a large supply of oil is going to make the price of oil rise. But it's hard to see it rising much, because the fracking revolution has essentially said the United States can turn on its gas rigs relatively easy at relatively low cost, and that's going to undermine the price of oil, the price of energy, for a long time for the foreseeable future. And fracking is spreading. It's not just the United States anymore. So I really don't think that the price of oil is going to rise very dramatically again.
And as we talk about oil, we talk about the OPEC countries arriving at a particular position of not trying to create a glut in the marketplace, et cetera, because they want to keep the price at a particular point. But now I have to tell you that several Caribbean states are anxiously looking at their own production of oil. We have Guyana, who ExxonMobil have said that they could produce as much as 500,000 barrels of oil a day. Jamaica has oil offshore. Barbados has oil offshore, I have to tell you. Trinidad, of course, is there with a great deal. The question here is whether the exploration cost of bringing that oil out of the sea, in the case of Guyana, for instance, is relevant at this time, or should we be holding our oil reserves for an opportunity when the price goes up dramatically?
Truly, I don't know. But I certainly hope that there's not that much exploration, because oil is a really filthy source of energy. It's not the worst, but it's a very dirty source of energy. And natural gas would be much cleaner for all concerned and comparable in price for the most part. And we know that there is going to be climate change. And the more oil that is produced and burned, the worse off we're going to be, or at least our kids and our grandkids are going to be. And I sure hope that there isn't a whole lot more oil exploration.
So we should turn our attention to alternatives.
Well, I think that's inevitable, and they're falling in price very quickly. And certainly lots of countries in the Caribbean that experience tremendous amounts of sunshine but also have access to wind offshore should be exploring that. The prices are going to be very comparable to fossil fuels very soon, and they already are in some places.
All right, before we go to the break, I want to ask you as well to talk about technology and its impact on everything is developing right now. Some people are complaining there's too much technology out there and the human being is being removed from the process, and the communication is really almost robotic. Well, it is anyhow, if we think of Alexa and so on. The question here is, if the region is to find new sources of employment and to also find new sources of generating income, revenue, is technology the next platform?
Technology is just a wonderful thing in general. There are some bad consequences. Not everyone gains from technology, but you spoke about robotics just a minute ago. I love the robots in my house because I don't want any member of my family to be washing clothes or washing the dishes, and those are quintessential robots.
Yes.
We have many fewer people washing clothes and dishes than we would have a generation ago. But those people aren't unemployed. They shift on to different sources of employment, things that make them happier and are more productive. Typically, you invent robots to do things that are dreary and burdensome and physically challenging. I think it's a good thing for human beings to do things that they find more interesting and that pay them a higher wage. So I'm a big believer in technology. It's one of the reasons why we're much better off now than we used to be 100 years ago.
All right, and one other quick one has to do with the IMF. It's a name that you're an institution you're very familiar with, and one name that keeps being raised time and time again as a source of solution for many of our regional problems in the economies.
Well, I certainly don't want to be viewed as giving advice to anyone in the economy, but the IMF has a pretty standard prescription, and when they're called into a typical Latin American country,
Caribbean,
but Latin American in particular, the expression used to be IMF stands for it's mostly fiscal, and what they love to do is encourage you to raise the taxes and chop the spending. They're known for austerity. Sometimes that's appropriate, sometimes it's not, but they typically are called in to do things that the countries know that they have to do themselves. And I feel that the IMF probably gets a bad reputation for providing expertise for things that the countries should have done and would have ordinarily done by themselves if the IMF didn't exist.
Is that so-called medicine easier to take if, as in some states have done, their own so-called structural program, designed a domestic program with support of the IMF and other agencies?
Well, the IMF makes it easier because they do provide financing, but they certainly want that financing paid back, which is the reason why they focus on fiscal things. But don't forget, usually when the IMF is called in, it's because there have been some domestic problems that haven't been dealt with. And having the IMF tell you what to do is really a tremendous thing because it's bitter medicine, but politicians can blame the IMF, even though they're feeding the IMF the ideas that the IMF is forcing them to do in the first part. So it's always great to blame someone else for doing what you need to do, especially if it's your idea to begin with.
All right, there you go. All right, so that's our first segment here as we continue our Caribbean Economic Forum. Remember, there are several ways in which you can participate, by phone, by email, and of course, we want to encourage you to continue to check Facebook Live, which is the Central Bank's Facebook page, and join the moderators there, who of course will respond to your questions and comments, and in fact, will continue long after we've wrapped up the session here. This is the Caribbean Economic Forum, live from the Courtney Blackmon Grand Salle of the Central Bank of Barbados in Bridgetown. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Caribbean Economic Forum. We're here at the Courtney Blackmun Grand Salle of the Central Bank in Barbados. I'm Julian Rogers, and my special guest, of course, is Andy Rose. He's the special distinguished visiting fellow of the Central Bank. We're going to go now for some feedback and questions and particularly quick comments from a number of people who are either online, email, or pick up via our Facebook page. On the line, in fact, is Dr. Darren Conrad, who is a lecturer at St. Augustine campus of the University of the West Indies. Good evening to you, Dr. Conrad. How are you doing?
Good evening, Julian. I'm doing pretty good. How are you?
All right. You followed the discussion I've had with Andy. What's your quick question or comment?
My comment is that one of the most salient points I think that stood out to me was that there is a recognition of a shift in economic power when he mentioned we should not only be looking at China, but Malaysia, Indonesia, and Singapore, and so on. But I, my question is, in most instances, in response to sort of preparing or dealing or responding to these types of global developments, which would be the shifting in economic power, to what extent is there any merit in possibly restarting the narrative of a sort of a economic integration of the region in terms of creating an economic power that can engage in a cooperative manner in trade negotiations and the likes with the new sort of economic power?
Okay. Are you suggesting CARICOM failed?
I did not say that.
All right. I couldn't help. Andy?
Well, the one thing that economists are more agreed on than anything else is that free and liberal trade is a good thing for all concerned. When a country liberalizes its trade, it typically gains. Not everyone gains. A few producers that are hit by imports lose, but consumers gain much more. And so economists are always in favor of more trade integration, greater liberalization. At this point, tariffs and non-tariff barriers are not the biggest things. They're usually, it's things like standards and ensuring that regulation is consistent across countries so that you don't have to have goods repackaged and just allowing for the freer flow of goods within an area. So economists are always in favor of greater integration, and so am I. I don't think that that's going to be a huge deal for most countries in the Caribbean, but it certainly can't hurt, especially when trade is going to be disruptive, certainly with the United States, but conceivably with other areas.
All right, let's turn our attention then to some more of the feedback, this time from within the Grand Salle itself. We've got a guest here this evening. Welcome. Can we have your question, please?
Thank you. My name is Crystal Howell, and my question is in relation to some advice that I'm hoping that you'll be able to give us. Barbados would have suffered from a number of downgrades recently and would have suffered the impact of those downgrades. You would have mentioned IMF as a source that usually promotes austerity. And Barbados is not alone in terms of suffering downgrades and falling to junk status, but there are a number of countries internationally and even regionally that have been able to recover some to the level of investment grade once again. Are there any examples that we would be able to use, because everything may not be applicable to our particular area, but are there any examples that could be used that may be applicable to us to help us to recover?
Well, it seems to me that the most obvious example right now would be Iceland. So Iceland is a country that had probably the single most serious experience through the financial crisis. It's an idiosyncratic, relatively small country, very much involved in tourism. So it's similar in size and scope to Barbados in a number of different ways, and therefore also to other Caribbean countries. Iceland went through the ringer. They did not go to the IMF. They knew what they had to do. They got help from the European Union. But they have completely restructured their economy. So if I were to look for an example, and you want to avoid going to the IMF and not do things in traditional ways, think of Iceland.
Thank you very much. Let's turn our attention now to email responses. And here's one message coming in. Andy, it says, given our dependence on tourism, how can Caribbean countries pursue development without the environmental degradation that we see in other countries? Should we just be following their models more carefully, or there are significantly different models that could be adopted that would help us avoid these pitfalls?
Well, tourism is clearly a very important part of the economy for many Caribbean countries. Every industry has its environmental issues, but it's not clear to me that the tourist industry is obviously worse than heavy manufacturing or even light manufacturing. And agriculture, of course, which used to be very important in this area, has tremendous environmental consequences. Also, I would say tourists that come down to the Caribbean are probably more concerned with greenery than other countries. So I think it's perfectly reasonable for Caribbean countries to essentially impose green taxes on tourists and on their own citizens because it's in their own national interest. I don't see any problem with that.
All right, back to this floor here of the Grand Salle. Good evening, ma'am. Go ahead with your question.
Yes, good evening. My name is Denise Mongerie Rogers, and my question is about cryptocurrency. We've been hearing a lot about cryptocurrency worldwide, and my question to you is, based on your experience, why do you think that financial institutions in the world are having such difficulty in regulating cryptocurrency? And based on our investment initiatives in the Caribbean, how do you see us moving forward in terms of cryptocurrency?
Well, many financial services and firms thereof really have no idea what's going to emerge in cryptocurrency because there are so many competing firms and so many competing standards. It's not clear that any are going to succeed. Something associated with blockchain is going to succeed. But cryptocurrency at this point strikes me as a bubble. And it's a bubble, and it's therefore very popular to discuss because it is a bubble. That's what everyone likes to discuss. But it's far from being a currency at this point. You can't use it to buy coffee at the local chafets here. I don't see that changing anytime in the foreseeable future. Digital currency in some form will emerge sooner or later, probably later, because for money to be accepted, it has to be regulated and trusted by the central bank and therefore for the populace. Nothing is going to serve it as a medium of exchange if it's purely privately backed. You cannot pay for something with a credit card without eventually settling your bill in money. It's hard to imagine cryptocurrency doing being anything different. I think we're in the dawn of this technology, and I bet none of the current cryptocurrencies will succeed. So I think this is a bubble that reasonable people can avoid for the time being.
Thank you, Andy. Let's go back now to the telephone. We've got a caller on the line. Good evening. Welcome to our forum.
Good evening. My question has to do with, as you spoke earlier about the new banking system, banking supervision that is going on around the world and making the financial system a lot better. But what I wanted to know is that there are no local banks anymore in Barbados, and all the banks are taking the direction and the supervision from their parent company and handing it down to the banks in Barbados, and it's making the system extremely onerous on Barbadians trying to do business with the banks in Barbados. What would be his advice, because our culture is different to theirs, and what would be his advice to us in Barbados?
Thank you, sir. Andy?
Well, don't forget, the fact that a country like Barbados doesn't have a serious domestic financial sector and doesn't have a large domestic bank, it certainly has its costs, and I'll talk about that in a second, but it also has its benefits. Don't forget, large numbers of banks had to be bailed out at enormous taxpayer expense in the 2008-2009 crisis all over the world. So not having your own banking sector does have its advantages because you don't have to bail them out. Nevertheless, part of the way that countries develop is to have a serious financial sector. The financial services industry is the brain of the economy. It's what allows an economy to figure out how to channel its resources. So what you want to do is have, if you're going to have an external financial sector, have a vibrant one, a competitive one. There are a number of big foreign banks in. if public policymakers are concerned about that, what they should really do is lower the barriers to entry to allow more Canadian banks and maybe even a few American banks in. They don't all have to be from North America, but lowering the barriers to entry in banking and maybe even in other industries would probably be a good thing for Barbados and most Caribbean countries.
I just want a clarification there. Not all the banks are only foreign owned.
Fair enough.
Okay. Although some people would say that because the bank is owned by Trinidad, that it's foreign. But it is a Caribbean bank.
I think I'm not going to go into that trouble. That seems like civil war to me, so I'm not going to pursue that one way or another.
Very smart, Andy.
Okay. Fine,
let's go back to the floor and welcome another one of our guests. Good evening. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is Gabrielle Gay. My organization is the Gabrielle Gay Award for Excellence in Reading and Literacy Mentorship Program. My passion is education. The thing about education is that it has direct links to the economic empowerment of any country. You know, studies have shown that persons have increased their economic input into their specific economies by 45% or more by being educated and having educated households. Now, with that said, it honestly bewilders me to the point of discombobulation sometimes with the lack of investment into education in Barbados and other territories. We have, for example, budgetary statements theoretically saying that $6.2 million have been allocated to education, etc., but working for 13 years on the ground, having a first-person perspective, this is not the case. Resources are very scarce. So herein lies my burning and ardent query. What can be done in your perspective? I'm sure you have a worldwide perspective on investment, on economies. What can be done to inject more into educations? What do you think can also be done to sensitize governments more on the importance of this? And how can we go about fixing this issue going forward to the future?
So that's a really important issue. I think of the three most important goals of the government as to provide for the common defense, common infrastructure, and capital development. And the most important form of capital is human capital. And the reason why governments should provide human capital is it's very much in their own best interest. Many of the benefits from human capital development do not flow to the individual, but flow to society. And the ways that government do that are primarily by providing healthcare and education. And if they do that inadequately, that's a serious problem. But let me actually try and be specific on what I think is a reasonable solution. Because education is a very difficult thing to monitor, in almost all Western societies, it's decentralized to the lowest level of government that's possible. So I live in Berkeley, California, which is a community one-third the size of Barbados, but we have our own school board. And most of the major decisions about hiring of teachers and principals and the way the school district is run are run at a very local level. And it's the localization of education, I think, subject to reasonable standards statewide or nationwide, that makes the educational system accountable to the parents and to the students. So localization seems to me the most appropriate solution.
Let's go back to the telephone now and pick up another one of our callers. Good evening. Welcome to our forum.
Good evening.
Yes, go ahead, please.
Yes, I'm joining you from Jamaica.
Okay, good evening, sir.
Good.
Is that Dr. Gordon Peter John?
Yes, it is.
Yes, welcome.
Thank you very much. I'd like the question of returning to the issue of banking. Small countries have been facing the possibility of debanking, which is a huge problem, and this is caused by the policies of the large, powerful countries, policies that have to do with anti-terrorism and anti-money laundering. What kind of advice could you give as to how we can navigate this space, which is closing us out of international economic activity?
Are you suggesting this under the rubric of de-risking, et cetera?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Andy.
So de-risking is just a very serious problem. It affects many different countries. They tend to be, of course, the countries that receive remittances and developing countries and emerging markets. One can understand the motivation to some extent, because you do want to cut down on money laundering and financing of terrorism. But I feel that it's reasonably clear that the northern countries have gone far too far in the de-risking approach. But there is no easy solution to this, and not one that I can see. You have the international organizations trying to help with, and the World Bank certainly leads on this, but not to any serious degree. I mean, there's no serious solution. And I just don't see that there's a viable solution to this problem at this point.
No comfort there.
Unfortunately, no. That's one of the advantages of being an academic. I can say there's a problem with no solution. Nobody's going to vote less for me because nobody's going to vote for me anyway.
Fair enough. We all know our places, right? Let's turn our attention to our guest here in the Grand Salle. Good evening, ma'am. Go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Jan Henderson. I'm the New Zealand High Commissioner. In about 3 weeks, the heads of the Commonwealth will be meeting. Now, that's 53 countries in the world, quite a different grouping. All small islands, or about half of small island states, and most of the Caribbean. And I'd just be interested in where you see the Commonwealth in terms of a force in impacting economically.
I have, to tell you the truth, I've never considered the Commonwealth to be a particularly important economic or political force. And I say that as a Canadian and as also a British citizen. It's just not at the forefront. Maybe once upon a time it used to be, but I can't think of a major policy initiative that was initiated or carried out by the Commonwealth. I'm sorry if that upsets you.
No, not at all. Just interesting, especially with Brexit and a suggestion that there may be other avenues for countries to meet and connect.
That didn't work for the UK in the 1930s, and I really doubt that it's going to work now. I mean, the UK does much more trade, and they're engaged in many more relationships with Europe because they're close to them. And there's a lot of people, a lot of rich people living in Europe, and that's most of the Commonwealth is far, far away. So I just can't imagine that changing anytime soon.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. Let's go back to the phones now and welcome Andrew Braffitt, who is the president of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of Barbados. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Professor Rose, you mentioned earlier that economists are always in favor of free and liberal trade. However, we've seen a lot of doubt about this recently among segments of the population in the major industrialized countries. How then do we convince Caribbean people that the principles of globalization and free trade are fair to small island developing states like ours? And what has been the empirical evidence so far?
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so a very good question and a really important topic. But I should say right at the outset, I am not Professor Rose, because Professor Rose is my mother. And the reason why people call me Andy is because when I hear Professor Rose, it's like my mother is right behind me. Not a good thing. Okay, but let me deal with the issue head on. The economics discipline is more united in favor of free trade than of any other issue in the entire discipline. And the reason is that it's always good for the national welfare. All of us are consumers. All of us gain when we buy cheaper imports. But many of us are producers. When those imports come in, they certainly hurt a small number of people who are engaged in the production of import competing things. So no one ever thinks that international free trade is good for everyone. And that's the reason why most countries that engage in international trade have to have a serious social safety net, so that the people who lose from import competition don't get abandoned by society, but have the opportunity to receive unemployment insurance benefits temporarily. There's a social safety net to make sure that they don't fall into destitution. And in the best of all worlds, they're encouraged to train and shift industries or occupations, or sometimes to move physically, to move to where new opportunities exist. Now, those social safety nets aren't perfect. And the United States is in favor of free trade, or at least used to be in favor of free trade, but is against social safety nets. And that's one of the reasons why the people who lost, especially from the imports from China, turned out to vote for Trump, and they were the ones that made Trump president. So it's clearly the case that some people lose. So what should be done? Well, I think the standard prescription is the right one. You want to do two things. First of all, you want to ensure that there's a reasonable social safety net for everyone, and in particular, so those dislocated by the effects of globalization do not fall out of society, but have some means to recover and can switch jobs. But you also want to have politicians and thinking people that benefit, that emphasize the benefits of international free trade. Small countries like the Caribbean countries could not survive with nearly the same standard of living if they try to produce everything themselves. These countries are very much the beneficiaries of globalization, and you have to have politicians keep on saying, we are better off because of free trade, and not everyone gains, we'll take care of them, but don't forget the benefits of free trade.
Let's stay with our contributions from the Grand South. We've got a journalist from Barbados with us.
Yeah, good night. My name is Joel Braffy, Advocate Newspaper, and I wanted to find out, there are two questions I want to put to you. The first relates to what is the future of the US dollar as a global reserve currency, and whether you think it will eventually be replaced by the renminbi of China. And the other question relates to the likelihood of a global economic crisis. You said you don't think that it will happen in your lifetime. But I want to remind you that recently Bill Gates of Microsoft said there's likely to be a crisis in another 3 years' time. Now, bearing in mind also that the 2008 financial crisis was not predicted by economists. So, and you're saying tonight that, you know, it wouldn't happen in your lifetime. Could you respond to those to me, please?
Sure. Okay.
I thought you said economists don't forecast.
Well, we certainly don't give a very specific time horizon if we do forecast. Okay, so you asked two questions, and they're both excellent questions. The future of the U.S. dollar, especially the future of the U.S. dollar as a reserve currency. Now, the United States dollar plays a really key role. Over half the reserves of the world are currently held in U.S. dollars because it's by far the most deep and liquid market, and the treasury bond market that supports it is unparalleled in its scope. I don't see any competitor for it at this point. China has serious capital flow restrictions. They're unlikely to remove those anytime soon. China's going to also have its own fiscal problems very, very soon. So I don't see that it's going to be replaced by the renminbi anytime soon. The more serious competitor for the United States dollar as a reserve currency, it strikes me, is the euro. If the European Monetary Union gets its act together, there is no reason why the euro couldn't be a competitor for the US dollar. And I also want to emphasize two other things before I leave this. First of all, the benefits of being the reserve currency are small and maybe negative. Okay, so how much does the United States gain because it has it has the status of reserve currency for the world at this point? Well, the standard estimates are about $50 to $60 billion per year, which is not small, it's not nothing, but it's not huge either. And most of those gains come from the fact that the United States produces and exports the $100 bill, which is used all over the world, almost always illegally. Okay, so when US dollars in large denomination bills are used outside the country, it's almost always illegal because you're supposed to use the domestic currency. And when they're used inside the United States, that's also a bad thing because it facilitates really bad behavior, such as it encourages tax evasion, prostitution, gambling, and drug dealing. So the gains are small. That $50 or $60 billion is a small amount of American tax revenue and could easily be negative. So if the United States lost its role as lender of last resort to the world, it was no longer the reserve currency, would that necessarily be terrible for the United States? I don't think so. So that's the first thing I want to say. The second thing I want to say is the world changes. If we'd been having this discussion 100 years ago, the most important economy in the world would have been the United Kingdom. And the UK issued the pound sterling, and that was the reserve currency of the world. These things change. Now it's the United States dollar. It's probably not going to be the same in 100 years. Who knows what it will be? It could be the United States with China, with the Europeans. Who knows? But these things are not written in stone. They don't stay fixed. So I agree with you. There will be some pressures on the United States. Your second question was about the global financial crisis. It wasn't predicted. Bill Gates is not an economist. He's a very rich guy, so he's allowed to make any forecasts he wants. But if you look at all the standard measures of whether there's going to be a financial crisis, you certainly don't see them in the financial markets. Now, everyone was taken by surprise by the last one. So there's no doubt about that. So the markets can be wrong. That is certainly true. But do I expect something of the same magnitude that's global in nature? I really don't think so, because I think the policy response will be much more aggressive next time. As soon as there's a financial crisis in any small country, there'll be very aggressive moves to make sure that it doesn't spread more widely. So it's the policy response that makes me feel reasonably confident we're not going to see another global financial crisis anytime soon.
That's the voice of Andy Rose. He's our special guest here, as a distinguished visiting fellow, guest of the Central Bank of Barbados. This is the Caribbean Economic Forum. We'll come back after this break and have a look at what's happening with Facebook Live.
I think this program visiting SARS that the Central Bank of Barbados has been conducting now for 5 years has been really a very interesting for the part for us, me and the other four participants, but also I hope for the people who listened to us and to talk to us and gave us so much of their time in Barbados, and also when material was being streamed out to the rest of the Caribbean. So it's been a great experience for me. It's not going to be my last trip to the Caribbean. I'm going to be down there in future, and I hope to be talking to you all again. Good luck, Barbados, and good luck to the rest of the region.
I think this Distinguished Visiting Fellowship is an opportunity for Barbadian policymakers, academics, and business people, and civil society more generally, to interact with academics from the rest of the world, to get unique perspectives on what it is that Barbados needs to do to continue its distinguished record of economic growth and empowering its citizens. I think it's particularly important to do this at this time because, as we know, global trade, global finance, the flows of people across borders, all these things have been centrally important to the growth of the world economy over the last four decades, and particularly important to small open economies like Barbados. And so it is with great pleasure that I reflect back on my 3 years ago having been a distinguished fellow, and I wish this program all the best and hope it continues into the future.
Welcome back, everybody. This, of course, is the Caribbean Economic Forum. And a reminder that this is the Central Bank's production. And our special host, of course, is the governor of the Central Bank, Cleverston Haynes, who is with us here in the audience at the Courtney Blackmun Grand Sal. Let's take a phone call for Andy. You've got a question? Welcome.
Hi, good night.
Yes, ma'am.
Good night to everyone. I have two questions. With the 1929 stock market crash happened in 2018, and does the stock market affect the economy? That are my two questions.
Okay.
All right, bye.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, you're going to have to.
All right. I think you're safe to answer about the impact of stock markets on the economy.
So the stock market has a very weak relationship with the economy. Paul Samuelson, one of the more famous economists from the 20th century, used to quip that stock market crashes have predicted 9 of the last 3 recessions, and that's still a valid point. We saw tremendous stock market volatility less than a month ago. We saw a lot of volatility last week. It doesn't typically persist, and the stock market typically moves independent of the real side of the economy, certainly over short periods of time. Sometimes it indicates stuff, much of the time it doesn't. It's just people playing with their own money in different ways. Don't forget, the stock market is a serious form of wealth, but it's not the only form of wealth. Most people have lots of bonds, and real estate is much more important, and much more important as a form of wealth is what's in your brain. Your human capital is a much more important form of wealth. So the stock market, you don't want to ignore it, but you don't want to obsess about it either.
Okay, thank you. Let's go to our email box and pull up a comment here. How many more times will OECD and FATF change the goalposts affecting de-risking that creates challenges related to the backlisting of countries like St. Lucia, Barbados? I can add some more countries anyhow in that list.
I feel confident that the OECD is going to continue to change its policies and tweak them forever, right? That's what they do, because at this point, I think there's a consensus that the de-risking strategies have been excessively onerous. And so we hope that they continue to change the goalposts. If they've made a mistake and made them too rigid, you'd like to make them less austere. And that's what policy makers do. They adjust with the data.
But we get the sense that we're being bullied.
That's what small countries always feel, and it's not wrong, right? Sometimes you are being bullied, and that's one of the things about having a rules-based way to conduct international relations. You'd like to have the same rules apply to the large and the small, and to some extent, that's one of the things that the OECD is supposed to be doing.
All right, I promise you that we'd check into our Facebook Live studio. So let's go to Winston and find out exactly how things are going there, Winston.
Hi, Julian and Andy. We had a really lively discussion on Facebook. One of the questions that came through from one of the members discussing on Facebook was in regards to one of the issues that Andy raised early this afternoon. He sort of recommended that the Caribbean could consider switching to Latin America to obtain more tourist arrivals. But one of the members on Facebook indicated that Latin American countries have also been impacted by de-risking. So the question was, what impact this switch would therefore have on us in the Caribbean, given that Latin America has also been affected?
Thank you, Winston. Andy?
I think of the de-risking issue as being almost unrelated to whether you should diversify tourism towards Latin America for a typical Caribbean country. You want the hotels to be full, you want the bars and the restaurants to be full, and you want a well-diversified group of countries to ensure that you're always at maximal reasonable capacity. The de-risking issue associated with financial regulation from the northern countries, yes, I think, is almost unrelated. The effects of that are unfortunate, but you can also overstate the importance of them. But diversifying your tourism, that strikes me as a good thing to do no matter what.
Let's go back to our audience here in the Grand Salle, and we got a comment, a question, sorry, coming from one of our guests. Good evening, ma'am. Microphone? Oh, sorry. Didn't see him. He's hiding behind the camera there. Good evening, sir. Go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Trevor Batson. I normally dabble in technology. I would like to find out something. I would like to suggest something. We, years ago, 700 BC, the Romans had a calendar started from this month, which is beautiful, to December. And then another Roman chap added 2 months, which was January and February. I want to find out if we can use that calendar to look at the last 4 months of our current calendar, which ends in BER. And BER comes out very good for Barbados economic recovery. Also, I am looking at it from the technical aspect, where it could mean Barbados email revolution. That said, that could go in hand with the tourism tech, because our tourism need to be developed, and the young people of Barbados have more cell phones than anybody else. And I was wondering how we could get the young people with their cell phones marketing and getting people to Barbados.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. Andy, that's a tough one.
So, I will say that I've never thought about that set of issues. I can honestly say I can't imagine that if we changed the number of months in the year, or for that matter, the number of days in the week, that it would really change that much. However, I will say there have been some experiments tried in the past. So during the French Revolution, they completely recast the calendar. It was not a success. It didn't stick. And I think of the calendar as being mostly a coordination mechanism that enables us all to talk about dates with precision between each other. I can't really imagine that there would be a benefit to shifting the standard in terms of the calendar. Now, time zones, which is a related issue, that's a different thing altogether, but perhaps we'll talk about that later on. Whether cell phones can be used to assist young people to work, now that is a serious issue. The cellular telephone is simply a wonderful device. And it enables people to waste time, but enables them to be much, much more productive as well. And they enjoy their leisure much, much more. There is lots of work that has been generated, especially for young people, through cellular services. Smartphone apps are, to a very large extent, written by young people. And so I think that's that level of technology and its continued development will be primarily good for the young in society, and I encourage that to continue as long as it can.
As we're talking about young, Andy, I think, in all fairness, I need to go back to the Facebook Live page and to Winston. Now, don't take that as anything negative, Winston.
No, I think it is positive that you're saying that I'm very young. So one more question, Julian. Given that there has been rising interest rates in more developed countries, what do you see as the likely impacts for Caribbean countries?
I'm sorry, the rising suicide
rate? No.
Interest.
Rising interest rates.
Interest rates.
In more
okay, interest rates, okay. Phew.
We haven't reached that stage yet.
Okay. So, it is certainly the case that interest rates have been rising in the northern countries, especially the United States, most dramatically, and they're likely to continue to rise. The Central Bank of the United States, the Federal Reserve, would like to see interest rates being more normal, more in the range of 4 or 5%, if possible. That seems unlikely. But they're certainly too low for the Fed's comfort at this point. Will they rise? Probably another 75 basis points, maybe more this year. They've already risen some. Everyone expects that to continue. But they will probably rise even more in the indefinite future, because the fiscal stimulus that the United States passed at the end of last year is going to put even more pressure on interest rates to rise. So I do think that northern interest rates, especially American interest rates, will continue to rise. What is that going to do? Anyone in the American orbit, that is, Canada, Mexico, the countries in the Caribbean, Central America, Latin America, but also the Pacific and East Asia, all of those are going to feel the effects of capital as it starts flowing towards the United States in search of those higher interest rates. That's going to raise interest rates and tighten monetary conditions in all of the financial periphery of the United States, and certainly including countries in the Caribbean. And it will also probably lead to an appreciation of the United States dollar. Any country that's fixed to the United States dollar, as for instance Barbados is, and the countries further north in the East Caribbean currency area, they will all be appreciating along with the United States. So I think this is going to have dramatic effects on all of the countries in the American financial sphere, especially countries that are fixed to the US dollar, not just in the Caribbean, but also Panama and Ecuador, El Salvador, Guatemala. It's going to affect lots of countries.
Thank you, sir. Let's go back to the floor and to the Grand Sal. We've got a...
Yes, one question over
yes,
here.
Yes, gentlemen.
Yeah, Timothy Boyce. Professor, I realize that we spend a lot of time on discussing the impact of European and North American countries on the Caribbean. But the Caribbean continues to be used as a factor of production in these countries, because these countries, they need to send their labor here to get that kind of recharge that is necessary for that labor to be productive in its own environment. Do you think that if the Caribbean, we have enough in the Caribbean in terms of Belize, in terms of Guyana, that if we could drive the Caribbean into operating as an economic block and have the freedom of movement of labor and capital, and then we increase the communication effects of the Caribbean by having the ferry service and a proper flight in terms of layout and travel within the Caribbean, I do believe that we have enough in the Caribbean that we could be sustainable without having to depend so heavily on tourism. Tourism, we depend on it for the foreign exchange, but I tell you, tourism drives those economies much more in their own economy than it drives ours, because Europe needs the vitamin D and what the Caribbean has to offer for that factor of labor in those islands to be productive. I want to hear your comment on that, sir.
So, integration of the Caribbean countries is a good thing, as is integration of most countries. Think of what integration is doing as primarily removing rocks from your harbors that you have placed there yourself. Okay. Protectionism is placing rocks in your own harbor, and integration, removing barriers from trade, is removing those rocks. And that's a good thing. Okay. Reducing the restrictions and removing barriers for commerce of goods or services or labor or capital generally leads to enhanced welfare. However, there are natural barriers to movement of anything between countries. It's difficult. Think of, for instance, the border between Switzerland and France just outside Geneva. Okay, that's a land border. The people speak the same language. They're in slightly different countries with very common characteristics. There's no legal reason why they can't move from one to another, but they never, ever do, because there are big cultural barriers. Very, very few people leave home. So while it's a good idea to remove barriers to the flow of people across borders, most people stay put. Greece has experienced unemployment rates of 40%, but the young people still don't move to Germany where there are lots of jobs, because it's Germany and it's not Greece. So I encourage integration. It's a good thing. You don't want to overpromise the benefits of integration. In practice, if all restrictions, all legal restrictions to movement inside the Caribbean were removed, it probably wouldn't lead to a very different status quo, except maybe between Haiti and the Dominican Republic, because Haiti isn't such a mess. You really don't want to overpromise what the benefits from integration can be.
But Andy, there's a point though that he raised in terms of production, and I think you, if just to familiarize you, he mentioned two countries, Guyana and Belize, great land masses. And in fact, you know, a long time ago, the president of Guyana did offer other Caribbean people to come to Guyana We've got enough space. We can give every one of you 200 acres, and you could do as much as possible. Belize, again, another great landmass where they've done a lot of cattle production and so on over the years. So I think what he's in essence saying is if more Caribbean people went to those two countries, we could have a higher level of production that would change the whole economic dynamics of the region.
I guess I would say the purpose of economic activity is not production, it's happiness, it's welfare. The fact that people don't move to places like Guyana or Belize, even when they could, indicates that they're happier staying put. And who amongst us should say to somebody, you have to move to Guyana or Belize or anywhere else, as opposed to staying put if you want to stay put? The point of having a liberal democracy is to enable people to lead lives the way they choose to do without the government telling them something to do.
All right. Fair enough. We've got another gentleman here. Welcome, sir, to the forum.
I'm Ricky Wayne. Good night. Very instructive so far. But I'm in trouble a little bit because we have a lot of discussion, and then I ask myself, well, here with sugarcane, and the sweeteners in the U.S. are highly subsidized, and U.S. economists are contending that sugar should actually be half the price of the U.S. consumer if it was allowed to flourish. Mm. I look around, I see all our lands are idle. And then I come to manufacturing, which we don't have the scale. And then I listen to tourism and see that the cruise ships is making the money. And then I look and ask myself, then, but if Brexit's going to hurt us, we tried with Latin America and with Gaul, and it's not as easy as it sounds. And then I come and see, well, now we're looking at the potential we had for remittances and FDI threatened by de-risking. Mm. And every time I look around, it looks as though every time we start, whether it is the offshore sector, then what happens? We're under severe pressure then with the OECD, and you still have to ask yourself, if this trend is to continue, what is going to stop the Caribbean countries and the trouble that we have with all the drugs and everything else? Because every opportunity that you go to pursue, you meet these barriers all the time. So I do share your view that we got potential for the urban capital, and everywhere in the world you can see Caribbean people doing very well. But now we've got, in addition to that, there's, if you even check with CNN, the potential that only Colorado could pursue, we would say, cannabis. Mm-hmm. And here's Jamaica that would be penalized for medical purposes. I'm not advocating one way or the other.
So, Ricky, can we get to a question?
So though? The question then I'm coming to, what do you see as the opportunities for Caribbean people against this kind of background?
Okay,
so I want to start off by saying life is not easy. And if you watch the news, you're never going to see a headline that says, you know, my son smiled today and it was a wonderful thing. I mean, my son actually phoned me a couple of hours ago. That's not newsworthy. Most news is bad news because people aren't interested in good news.
You're putting me out of business now.
Nevertheless, if you're a sane person and you want to be reasonable, you have to remember that progress is the norm. It is not the exception, it's the norm. Every decade that we live, 2.5 years of that are free because your lifespan has been extended by modern medicine and modern technology by a few years. I bet everyone in this room has a smartphone. None of us had them 10 years ago. They would have been essentially unthinkable. There's lots of good news. There are always barriers. I understand that. I'm not denying it. But we tend to ignore the good things that happen to us. And that's an important thing for me to stay sane. Okay, nevertheless, let me ask your answer your question head on. Countries do best when they specialize in pursuing economic activities in which they have a comparative advantage. Barbados used to have a serious comparative advantage in sugarcane production. That's fallen off, although it's still there to some extent. As societies all over the world get richer and richer, people want to go on vacation to nicer and nicer places. It strikes me that the natural and increasing comparative advantage of many Caribbean countries, certainly including Barbados, is tourism. And that's a very income elastic sector, to use the technical term, because as people get richer, they spend disproportionately more on luxury goods like a vacation in Barbados. So if I was going to be a young person and I wanted to stay in Barbados, I would want to enter the tourism industry in something that I thought was going to deliver a high wage for me in the future.
Let's go back to the mailbox, and here's a comment or a question, is it? Let's see what comes up. For the Caribbean, how viable do you see app development, entrepreneurship, and cultural industries as new ways to thrive?
I'm sorry that that is going to be just beyond my level of expertise. I'm just unable to answer a question like that. It's one of the great things about being an academic. I'm allowed, and indeed I'm even encouraged to say in response to questions, I don't know. So I don't know.
Fair enough. Let's go to the floor then, and we've got one gentleman on his feet. Good evening, sir.
Good evening to you. My name is Steve Hunt, the sheriff, and I'm representing Barbados right here in a political persuasion in 2018 elections. My question is like, based on the economic model. My question is, shall Barbados begin to make its own model, that this model can be used to be driven on the global, international, and regional local economy roles of the world, so that we can understand the way forward as a small island developing state, and we will have a vehicle that is made in the Caribbean to be driven worldwide, that we can service the GIRL, what I call the global, international, regional, and local economies of the world. And my question is to the professor is that, what can you give to Barbados as a small island development state, as a professional person in your persuasion of economics? How can we continue as a Caribbean to develop economic policies to further our development when it comes to politics and economics, administration of national development, and the rule of law? Thank
you
very much.
Okay. So I guess the first thing that I'd like to say is there is no special place for developing your own economic model in the sense of it being imitated. Okay, there's no benefit to doing something that's admired in other countries and imitated in other countries. What Barbadians want, I assume, is to be as best off as they possibly can. And whether the rest of the world thinks that's a good thing that they can imitate or not, that's in some sense simply irrelevant. Agents should do what's best, what's in their own best interests. But let me be a little bit more specific, because you seem to be asking what should be done at this point, okay? When I think about the Barbados economy, which I'm the first to say I'm not an expert in, I think that it faces serious constraints right now. And in particular, very little can be done on the monetary side in the short run, because the exchange rate is fixed. The central bank provides a very credible nominal anchor. I don't think anyone would like that to change, and nobody would know what it would change to. So the fixed exchange rate is a serious and reasonable constraint. The government is already running a fiscal deficit. They have reduced that, but clearly there's very limited fiscal space given the amount of debt that's been built up. So if Barbados wants to continue to push forward, as it should, it seems to me that the policy space has to be on the supply side, enhancing productivity by reducing unnecessary regulations, reducing black tape, red tape, and in allowing especially young people to form startup businesses and to enter sectors that they want to, hopefully well equipped by the educational system.
Is that your parting shot?
I'm happy to take it. I think supply side deregulation has to be the way that Barbados goes at this point.
Thank you very much, Andy. And one last visit to the Facebook Live. Come back in, Winston.
Hi, thanks a lot, Julian. So a number of issues were raised in the Facebook discussion. I'll just summarize some of the issues for you this afternoon. We had a discussion or a question raised about the link between Airbnb and part of a strategy for community-based tourism. There have been lots of questions about tourism in the Facebook discussion. There's also a question asking about the link between free trade and the balance of payments constraint. Given in Barbados, we definitely face this hard foreign exchange constraint as we try to maintain the exchange rate peg. So that question was in that vein. We had some questions in regards to sustainability as well. So one, looking at what is the link between green economy and growth of new systems of development. There was also a little bit of discussion on what full employment means for us in the Caribbean. Caribbean economies have unemployment rates that range from around as high as 20% to Barbados, which has an unemployment rate of around 10-11%, to Trinidad, which has an unemployment rate of 7%. So just what does full employment mean for us in the Caribbean compared to, say, the United States, where unemployment can go to as low as 4%? We also had lots of questions about de-risking and how do Caribbean countries recover their financial sectors after the impact that de-risking has had on the financial sectors.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Winston. Quick.
Well, let me just touch on three things. Barbados faces a balance of payments constraint, as do all countries. And the easiest way to reduce that balance of payments constraint is to raise exports. Barbados's comparative advantage seems to be in perhaps in international financial services, but also especially in tourism. That's the way you want to go. Sustainability is a big issue for many countries. It turns out that green technology is actually very profitable, and moving your economy towards more sustainable forms of production that reduce environmental impact turns out to be a very profitable thing for many businesses, so I expect more of that to continue. The final thing is the unemployment rate. Unemployment rates vary dramatically across countries and across time. The one thing you want to remember is that an unemployment rate of zero is neither desirable nor feasible. What you want is a situation where people who lose their jobs find viable alternatives after a reasonable period of time. What that unemployment rate is, the full employment rate, as it were, it's not zero, it's probably not 10%. There's tremendous uncertainty, even for a country like the United States. Some people think it's 3%, some people think it's 7%. Most Caribbean countries are above it, but maybe not so much above it.
And now I'm going to say thank you very much, Andy.
Thank you. Pleasure.
And that's it. Very happy to have had you come and spend this fifth edition of the Caribbean Economic Forum with us here at the Central Bank. And, of course, I want to say thank you to the governor of the Central Bank, who's been our host here this evening. Thank you, Governor. And thank you to the entire team here at the Central Bank and all the production support that we've had as well. I'm Julian Rogers at the Grand Salle of the Central Bank in Bridgetown, Barbados. Our thanks, of course, to Winston Moore and his team acting as moderators out of Facebook Live. And I want to thank everybody else for coming and joining us, whether you were here in the Grand Salle, joining us online, and everywhere else on radio and television around the Caribbean and the rest of the world. Thank you, everybody. See you next time in a year's time.